Long time no bark, humans. My name is Professor Meatball, PH Dog, and I am talking about how to spot a fake data scientist today. I put a surprise at the end of the video, so I'll see you there. Ow!
Are you still there? To delete this message,
how's it going? Welcome back to Data Leap. We are bringing data science down to earth. My name is Andrew, and we are going to talk about our favorite meme lord, salt master, king of the drama data scientist, John Singer, electrical engineer, data scientist, man after my own heart.
I am actually about to get fired after 6 months on the job. That's sad. I just passed the 6 month mark and I still have not been fired. Oh! Final update, I have officially been let go. Now with the coronavirus, nobody's hiring. Help!
What a roller coaster.
He answers a question. And the question today is, can a data scientist fake it until they make it? He gives his personal take on whether or not a data scientist can fake it. Unfortunately, I think you can, but only in an unsuspecting organization that doesn't know any better. A fake data scientist is what we call a black box button pusher.
Okay, that's a lot of words.
That is. They can instantiate pre-made library functions but have no clue what goes on under the hood. In fact, I have a fake data scientist in my team who was hired before I came, and I knew she was fake from day one. This man is the master of salt. This man is very good at creating this kind of drama in his own team. His full name is here, unless that's not his real name. But if it is his real name, the fact that he was able to talk about his own team like this, She can answer all the basic questions like supervised learning versus unsupervised learning that'll fool most people, but she didn't fool me, John Singer. Master of data. Fake data scientists are a big issue these days. If you've heard of a company, Data Robot, they claim one of the big reasons they came into existence is because there were too many fake data scientists hidden in an organization. This is true, but this also strikes me more as a marketing point for their business. I do not work for Data Robot.
That's a perfect ploy for someone who does.
And I am not endorsing their product. I just like their philosophy on fake data scientists. Besides, I hear they have a huge toxic culture with a high turnover, but then again, that sounds like every other tech company on Glassdoor. Lol, our boy John, back with the lols. He just not only called out his team member, someone who can be verifiably, like,
doxed
from his company. He also calls out this whole other company and says they're toxic, and then he calls out every single tech company on Glassdoor. To be a man with so few flips to give. Oh, see the field in which I sow my flips and see how barren it is. You gotta love John. Wow, he makes good content. He should be a YouTuber. I wanna subscribe to him. By the way, subscribe, like. If you like this, if you wanna see more John, this could just be a John channel. Companies don't know how to hire real data scientists. Consequently, they hire some good ones and some fake ones. This is true. In the sense that companies who hire data scientists, and I'm going to cover this in an entirely separate video, but they're often looking for someone who is either a machine learning engineer or they're looking for someone who's a data analyst. Data scientists perform both of these tasks, but they're not necessarily someone who lends their skills in creating this task. It's been prevalent through the entire industry. Before data scientists, they were business intelligence consultants. This conflates the two positions that almost have nothing to do with each other. A data analyst munges through data, picks and chooses what they want to see, and then maybe puts it through Excel and presents it on a PowerPoint. They need to have the interpersonal skills in order to make sense to every other data stakeholder. So the designer, the product manager, the salesperson, they all have to understand what the data analyst is saying. So therefore, there's a lot of interpersonal communication and cross-functional team support. But a data scientist, they work with data in a more theoretical and model-based sense. They'll pump data either through a very high-functioning algorithm, but in the higher end of the spectrum, they'll be working on machine learning models and artificial intelligence. This is a blanket term for the kinds of deep learning models that exist in industry. So when Amazon recommends a hit movie or Netflix knows which exactly what show you'll be dying to see when it comes out, that's because a data scientist, a machine learning engineer, was able to plug that in the back end. That person doesn't necessarily have to make pretty graphs. That's an entirely different job. It's like combining a baker and a bricklayer. A bricklayer can build an oven, then the baker uses the oven. So I guess they're kind of related. But you see that if you have or don't have the infrastructure already in place, you truly only need one or the other. Let's keep going. The norm or trending norm today is to have data scientists in every department, such as marketing, HR, etc. So what ends up happening is there are many fake data scientists hidden in each department. Sure. John's coming to the point that like data scientists work in silos. In a FANG company, each data scientist actually might not work together on sharing different resources, on collaborating on specific projects, on recreating code or removing the need for superfluous code. They'll actually work depending on what team they're on. So an HR data scientist might actually never talk to a marketing data scientist, depending on how big the team is, depending on how big the company is. So that's problematic because one, you're wasting a lot of potential because models and product senses flow very well throughout a company, right? So a data scientist is always working with half of the picture. They're not working with the whole picture. The other problem with this is that with this divide of information, John is saying that suddenly you don't have the ability to understand how many fake data scientists there are, right? If there was a big headcount every single year and we said, okay, these data scientists measure up here and these data scientists measure up here, that would be easier. But therefore it's harder since there's so many different siloed data scientist roles. Fake data scientists build bad models, which is actually worse than having no data scientist because they build flawed models that do more harm than good. After all, when a data scientist builds a model, most non-data science staff do not question the validity of the model. Hardly anybody pauses to ask, is this person doing the right thing? Is he qualified to do this? What qualifies him? I have to say that the problem with this argument is that when you go to a dentist or a doctor and say, show me what qualifies you.
What?
They can show you the piece of paper, right? They can show you that they had the degree, they had the residency. Experience compounds and layers on expertise and professionalism. It's not easy to see out in the open. I would never go up to someone and ask them on a team, what qualifies you to make design, right? What qualifies you to make scalable infrastructure as an engineer? What qualifies you to sell as a salesperson? But at the same time, he is right that nobody asks whether or not the model is correct. This is integral, right? You need to test. Engineers don't like to do it. Data scientists don't like to do it. But if you don't have the tests to back up your model, that will do more harm than good. And that's true for both fake data scientists and real data scientists. I suppose what he's trying to say here is, it's not like you can catch a fake data scientist with a model, especially since human explainability goes out the window for modern machine learning. And the more abstracted from human understanding, the easier it is for a fake data scientist to get away. Finally, data robot uplift themselves. Caught a typo. Finally, data robot uplifts themselves by saying that the answer to this issue is one of their products, which of course is AutoML. AutoML is huge today to where data scientists might soon become less desired because you have an online tool that does all the math, science, and model picking for you. John, come on, man. What are you doing? Giving out all the secrets, such as how much a data scientist makes over here on the top left corner. It knows what algorithm to pick and tune. All you need to do is the feature engineering part and feed in the right data. This really is the future, AutoML, CloudML, etc. But we are still not there yet because most companies need a data scientist to take care of at least some of these things in-house. This reminds me of that Simpsons quote where there's this general and he's talking to a bunch of recruits and he says, in the future, all wars are going to be fought with tiny robots, but there will be people to maintain and clean those robots, and those people will be you. This is true. AutoML will reduce the necessity for data science, but like I cover in a couple of my videos, data science is still a big mismatch between demand and supply, in the good way. Data scientists are in heavy demand, and until ML becomes a lot more reliable and a lot more human explainable, it's not going to catch on as quickly as John is foretelling it will. But once it does catch on, it actually still necessitates a good data scientist. So this just is a positive feedback loop. You want to be as good of a data scientist as possible, understand your statistics, understand your calculus, understand your linear algebra, and then when they need someone who can actually oversee all of these AutoML automations, you're that guy. That's you. You did it. On that last point, you may not even need a real data scientist in the future. A data analyst or a fake data scientist could just upload data to a cloud platform and run a few tests and get results. Remember that the AutoML tools will pick the model, optimize, and give you the results. Heck, the technical manager could do that. I would love to know how to read. Remember that the AutoML tools will pick the model, optimize, and give you the results. Heck, a technical manager could do that at that point, and even a marketing guy. I worked in a company that tried to abstract natural language models as easy to work with as possible for a non-technical consumer. I have to say that a marketing person can do it, yes, but a marketing person will ultimately become a consultant, right? A solutions consultant, as the industry would like to say. That person ultimately becomes a handholder, and therefore, they cannot scale, right? They're not the person that actually ends up controlling all the automation. They're actually just the person that sells and provides support for consumers that use this product. All until that gets automated too, but we're not there yet. To be fair, there are about 50 companies that have such AutoML tools. Only 50. John can name them all. Can you? To be fair, John is very fair. I would like John Singer for president. But as of today, let's assume you still need data scientists in-house to run complex models. How do you know if the person you are hiring is good enough? Here is my definitive list. This should be its own video. I feel like I've had so much fun with John today. This should be his own video. John is such a, wow. There's so much more. John.
Are you still there? To delete your message, press 7. To save it in the archives, press 9. To hear more options, press 0. What are you talking about?